Coming up on today's show, Audi uses fear of Tesla to motivate its employees, Waymo launches public self-driving car trials in Phoenix, Arizona, and the Nissan Leaf that's driving from the UK all the way to Mongolia. No, seriously. These stories and more coming next on 10. Like all our content, today's show is funded by the in-stream ads on today's video and by the kind donations of viewers like you. Follow the link at the end of today's video to make a monthly donation to our Patreon crowdfunding campaign to help keep us independent and impartial. And if you're already donating, thanks for your continued support. It's Friday, 28th, 2017. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and this is T.E.N, the automotive equivalent to This Week Tonight, but with less John Oliver, Donald Trump, and lols. As recently as a year ago, luxury German brands like BMW, Daimler, and Audi were playing it cool, telling anyone who would listen that they were far from scared of upstart Tesla and its range of super-fast all-electric cars. But in recent weeks, Daimler, Audi, and Porsche have all admitted that Tesla is a major threat to their established market share. And this week, we learned that BMW is actually leveraging fear of Tesla among its employees to encourage them to do everything they possibly can to help BMW catch up with Tesla's electric lead. As Elizabeth Berman of Bloomberg reports, BMW has been holding regular pep rally / horror film showings, complete with images of rival luxury cars and Elon Musk. The message? That the auto industry is in the midst of an electric assault which must be taken very seriously, and that BMW needs to do everything it can to develop electric vehicles which are better than Tesla's. Following the slashing of Model S 60 and 60D battery unlock prices earlier this month, Tesla has confirmed that it will be slashing the battery capacity unlock price for Tesla Model X 60D owners to just $4,000. Yes, it's still twice the unlock price for the 60 and 60D Model S, but this particular upgrade is more attractive than ever before for Model X owners. And while I'm on the subject of Tesla unlocks, I should note here that Tesla has begun pushing a new software update to all Tesla cars fitted with Autopilot 2.0 hardware, which should activate automatic emergency braking on these cars and finally bring them in line, feature parity, with Tesla Autopilot 1.0 cars. It's taken longer than Tesla had originally planned, but here's hoping the upgrade push goes without a hitch and finally makes Tesla Autopilot 2.0 owners a little happier. Talking of happy, it seems owners of the Chevrolet Bolt EV, or 3,500 of them, seem to be making plenty of use of the 238 miles of EPA-approved range that each Chevrolet Bolt EV is capable of. So much so that as of April 2nd, the 3,492 Bolt EV owners in the US at that time who'd had their cars had totaled more than 4.5 million cumulative miles of zero tailpipe emission driving, with one owner managing 310 miles on a single charge and on a single continuous trip. But it also admits that the average Bolt EV owner covers just 53 miles per day in their car, something that will make hardened EV fans like me laugh, since we've been telling everyone that 100-mile electric cars have been suitable for the needs of 95% of the population for years. Still, I guess the extra 185 miles on top of that 53 miles is useful for long-distance trips, right? I mean, that's why I'd buy a longer-range car. Probably will at some point. While most of us will likely stay buying plug-in cars for some time, Alphabet's self-driving arm, Waymo, has just launched a new program in Phoenix, Arizona, which not only previews a day when we might not be owning our own cars, but also not driving them. The first ever public trial of its fully autonomous vehicle program, Waymo is inviting residents in the greater Phoenix metro area, including Gilbert, Chandler, Tempe, and Mesa, to sign up to become early riders in its autonomous vehicle program. With 500 cars and 500 trained drivers monitoring the vehicles at all times, it's a great way to experience autonomous vehicles firsthand and to get a free ride, because there's no charge to take part. You're only asked for your opinions. Head to waymo.com to find out more. Back to Tesla now with four quick updates regarding Model 3. At the start of this week, Tesla announced it would be doubling the number of supercharger stations around the world in preparation for Model 3, expanding existing sites and building new ones, with some sites primed to get up to several dozen stalls each. It's been met with applause from most Tesla owners, but Roadster owners are begging Tesla not to leave them behind, as they still have to rely on the old 80-amp, 240-volt Tesla charge stations that are becoming increasingly rare. Along with expanding its supercharger network, Tesla says sales and service will grow too, and it's just made the training and approval process to become an authorized Tesla repair center cheaper and quicker, something which should help eliminate the backlog of Tesla owners who found themselves waiting weeks for accident repairs. Finally, Tesla has taken delivery of the first batch of Model 3 destined robotic production equipment and has also smoothed out threats of industrial action at the recently acquired Grohmann Engineering in Germany, where a lot of the Tesla Model 3 production equipment will be made. And it's done that by offering the 700 or so employees there a substantial pay rise. Essentially, Tesla is oiling the wheels to make sure everything goes according to plan when Model 3 launches later this year, something that absolutely must go without a hitch. All I can say is that I'm glad I don't work at Tesla right now, because I'm sure there's a little more stress than I would like there. They say imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and in this case, Tesla should be very flattered indeed, because Audi has just opened up reservations in Norway for the e-tron Quattro electric SUV, long before it's even produced official pricing. To join the queue to buy one, customers have to put down 20,000 kroner, that's just under $3,000, and then wait until next year for the car to actually enter production. Yes, this is very Tesla, right down to the not announcing final specifications or pricing. But actually, while people think of Tesla as pioneering that technique, I want to remind everyone that Nissan and Chevy both offered online reservations way back in 2010 for the Nissan Leaf and Chevy Volt. So maybe it's just an EV thing. On this show, you'll know I cover anything that's cleaner, greener, safer, and smarter. And while this next story certainly ticks two of those boxes, I'm not sure about the other two, because this is the Flyer, a flying vehicle that's a cross between a water ski, a hoverboard, and, well, a quad bike. Powered by an all-electric drive system, this one-seat propeller-driven flying bike is the first vehicle to come from Kitty Hawk, a startup backed by Google's Larry Page that's just come out of stealth mode. Eventually, the company wants to build a fully working flying car, but for now, it'll sell you the Flyer from the end of this year. It looks fun to fly, and I'm not sure about the learning curve, but as to its safety, well, if you've ever crashed a drone, I think you get my concerns. Still, it's really cool, and I still want to go. What about you? For some time now, it's been no secret that Tesla electric cars, especially the Model S and Model X, retain their value as they age with very little depreciation compared to other cars of any fuel type. But this week we learned via AutoList that Tesla Model S cars sell far quicker than the competition in the used car marketplace, with the average used Model S selling in 87 days, around 5% quicker than other competing vehicles. What's more, the listing prices for Model S sedans were between 3 and 5% more than their competitors in the used car marketplace. And that's just helping to push Tesla shares even higher as investors grow in confidence that Tesla and its cars are a good deal. From cars now to how they're powered, or rather, how they're not powered. You see, last Friday in the UK, for the first time since the Industrial Revolution, not a single piece of coal was used to power the country for an entire 24 hours. Over the past few years, burning coal for electricity generation has dramatically dwindled in my home country, replaced by cleaner, although still emissions-producing natural gas, increased renewable energy use, and increased nuclear power. While it's a good shift towards cleaner power, the UK, like the rest of the world, needs to make sure that it doesn't replace coal-powered electricity with other fossil-fueled electricity, or indeed nuclear power. Instead, a continued investment in distributed renewable energy and products like the Tesla Powermall will make the biggest impact. Let's hope things go the right way moving forwards. Back in the noughties, long before cars like the Nissan Leaf even came to market, BMW's Mini brand produced limited numbers of the Mini E, a two-seat all-electric conversion of the Mini Cooper. But despite this, BMW hasn't yet produced a production electric Mini that you can buy. And while late last year, Mini confirmed an all-electric production model was coming, in addition to the recently launched Mini Countryman plug-in hybrid, some question remained as to what an all-electric Mini would be like and what its position would be in the company. Well, this week, we've heard confirmation that Mini bosses want the all-electric Mini to be one of its brand superheroes, a mainstream model that not only represents the brand as a whole, but entices new customers in, something that's not a compliance car, but rather a fully-fledged, well-engineered, high-performance electric Mini that will sell just as well as the rest of the range. Sadly, there are no more details at present, but I, for one, can't wait to see what this model will turn out like. And finally, if you've ever spent any time with a Nissan Leaf, you'll know it's a very competent electric car, which, with some help from decent DC quick charging networks, can be used to make some pretty successful long-distance trips along major routes. if you've got the charging infrastructure. But the guys at Plug-in Adventures are about to do something completely different with a lightly modified Nissan Leaf. Take part in the 10,000-mile Mongol Rally from the UK to Mongolia. With the rear seats stripped out, the suspension raised, a special adventure light bar fitted, along with heavy-duty roof rack, and the car wearing some chunkier rally tyres and wheels, the Leaf, dubbed ATEV, will be tackling some of the toughest rally conditions possible on this publicly enterable endurance event, just to prove that electric vehicle travel is only as difficult as you make it. Good luck, guys, and here's to a successful completion of this incredible rally. Talking of completion, that's your lot for today. As always, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Visit transportevolved.com for more cleaner, greener, safer, and smarter transportation news, or join in the conversation on Twitter at transportevolved. And if you liked what you saw today and want to help us make more shows like this, please consider making a donation to our Patreon crowdfunding campaign. I've left a link in the description below and a clickable one at the end of today's video. Thanks again for joining me this week. I'll see you next time. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. That was 10. Have a great weekend. And until next time, keep evolving.